Welcome back, everyone. This is the first lecture for Chapter 4, Magma, Igneous Rocks, and Intrusive Activity. Igneous rocks form from molten rock we call magma. When the magma cools and solidifies, it becomes an igneous rock. Some general characteristics of magma: it is the parent of the igneous rocks. It forms by partial melting of the Earth's crust, such as in decompression and flux melting, previously discussed in Chapter 2. And when magma comes to the Earth's surface, we refer to it as lava. Lava may explode violently or quite peacefully. In this image, we're looking at lava flows and some fountaining of lava. This is an example of non-violent volcanic eruption. Magma is made up of solids, minerals, for example, the liquid portion, and volatiles, the most common volatile being water vapor, others including carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide as well. The volatiles remain in solution when the magma is under pressure at great depths within the Earth. When the magma comes to the Earth's surface, the lower pressure allows the volatiles to come out of solution, producing a release of gases. The term crystallization is used when magma cools and results in a systematic arrangement of ions. The silicon and oxygen link together first to form that silicon oxygen tetrahedron. Remember, silicate minerals dominate igneous rocks. As the magma continues to cool, the heat loss continues, the tetrahedron will join with other ions and form crystal nuclei. So the earliest forming minerals have space to grow and tend to be better developed with crystal faces than minerals that crystallize later. This magma cooled, producing the igneous rock granite, which consists of potassium feldspar, amphibole, plagioclase feldspar, and quartz. Magma that crystallizes at depth we refer to as plutonic or intrusive. And in fact, most magma never does reach the Earth's surface. It cools within the Earth. We get a view of these rocks that have cooled at depth when tectonic forces come into play, when mountain ranges are uplifted and the overlying material is eroded, weathered away. We then have an exposure of the plutonic structure. The solidification of lava forms volcanic or extrusive igneous rocks. So summarizing, we have plutonic slash intrusive igneous rocks cooling within the Earth, and lava or volcanic debris that forms at the Earth's surface, solidifies at the Earth's surface, and we refer to those as volcanic or extrusive igneous rocks because they have been extruded onto the surface of the Earth. This image shows magma within the Earth, intrusive, and extruding out onto the Earth's surface in a lava flow. Once that magma cools, once the lava cools, we then have intrusive igneous rocks and extrusive igneous rocks. Reviewing from our Chapter 3 on minerals, igneous rocks are composed primarily of silicate minerals. Remember, dark silicates called ferromagnesium minerals consist of iron and or magnesium attached to the silicon oxygen tetrahedron. Examples of our ferromagnesian silicates include olivine, pyroxene, amphibole, and biotite mica. On the other hand, our light or non-ferromagnesium silicates contain potassium, sodium, calcium, rather than iron and magnesium. So examples of common light silicates include quartz, muscovite mica, orthoclase feldspars, and plagioclase feldspars. This figure is quite busy, and I will be referring to it throughout the lectures. We start at the top with the composition of magma. We have four choices for compositions. We have felsic, andesitic or intermediate, mafic or basaltic, and then our ultramafic compositions. As we go from left to right, changes occur. Our silica content decreases, our temperatures increase, our iron and magnesium increase left to right, and our potassium and sodium decrease left to right. These are our textural terms that we'll get into more detail later in this chapter. Phaneritic, the term phaner, P-H-A-N-E-R, refers to visible. So an igneous rock with a phaneritic texture is coarse-grained, large crystals, large enough to be seen with the unaided eye. Examples of igneous rocks exhibiting the phaneritic texture: granite, diorite, gabbro, and our peridotite. Aphanitic igneous rocks, A means not, and then here's our fan, so not visible crystals: rhyolite, andesite, basalt, and comadiites, which no longer form at the Earth's surface due to cooling of the planet. This table is read then as you progress down. It wasn't a very straight line, but the granite and rhyolite contain these minerals: muscovite, quartz, potassium feldspar, plagioclase, biotite, amphibole, and you can see that it ranges in percentages. Andesites, you could draw a line down as well. So andesites, you can see, are dominated by the plagioclase feldspar. The quartz almost disappears, and an increase in our ferromagnesian minerals like amphibole. With our basaltic composition, you draw your line straight down, we still have a lot of plagioclase feldspar, and now pyroxene is coming into play as being a common mineral, and amphibole is disappearing. Finally, in our last column, our ultramafic composition, it is overwhelmingly dominated by olivine, with maybe a little pyroxene and plagioclase feldspar. Looking at the two broad groups of igneous rocks, granite or granitic, which is felsic, versus basaltic or mafic compositions. The granitic or felsic compositions contain our non-ferromagnesium silicate minerals, such as quartz and potassium feldspar. It has a high silica content, SiO2, silicon dioxide, we can call silica. In excess, in fact, of 70% silica. Very little dark silicate minerals, 10% we can say. And granitic composition is the composition of the continental crust. Our basaltic or mafic composition magmas contain at least 45% dark silicates and calcium-rich feldspar instead of sodium-rich feldspar. No quartz. It's gone. The term mafic comes from magnesium and ferrum for iron, They are higher in density because of the iron and magnesium, and basalts are common on the ocean floor and volcanic islands. We can also find basaltic deposits on the continents, and we'll talk about flood basalts later in this chapter. Differentiating between the granitic or felsic composition, which contains biotite mica, sodium-rich plagioclase feldspars, potassium feldspars, and quartz, and our basaltic or mafic, you can see the darker color, and you would see these minerals under magnification under a polarizing light microscope because the texture for this basalt is aphanitic. The main point being we are going from a light to a dark colored igneous rock because our compositions are changing. We are going from a felsic or granitic to a mafic or basaltic composition. We'll look at intermediate and ultramafic compositions of magma in our next video, video 2, for chapter 4 on igneous rocks. See you then.